going to now introduce Dr. Coe, Dr. Howard Coe. He is former Assistant Secretary of Health and is currently the professor of the practice of public health leadership and director of the leading change studio at Harvard School of Public Health. Again, the material in your book, in your handout material, contains a complete, more complete description of Dr. Ho's accomplishments and positions. I really appreciate the fact that he's with us. He's demonstrated a lot of leadership while with the government on this topic and a number of other topics. And it's really a great pleasure to welcome you to make some comments to get our conversation started. Howard, please join us.
Thank you so much, Dr. Isham. Good morning, everybody.
Good morning.
First of all, it is great to be back in D.C.
Yeah.
In fact, this is my first presentation since leaving the Department of Health and Human Services several months ago as the Assistant Secretary for Health. They used to call me the Ash there, by the way, if I happen to use that term. So I am very, very grateful to be back to see wonderful colleagues and friends here at the IOM and to talk about an issue that we all care so passionately about, and most importantly, to honor the pioneers and leaders who are in this room who have created such tremendous progress over the last decade. I'm really humbled to stand before you, to celebrate with you, to thank you, and to see how we can work better together to advance this field in the future. And so much has happened in the past decade, despite the giant obstacles of this field. This is a field that's not viewed as glamorous by many. It may not necessarily attract headlines, but it's absolutely at the core of everything we do as healthcare and public health professionals. As my friend, the late Reverend William Sloan Coffin, liked to say, giant obstacles are brilliant opportunities, brilliantly disguised as giant obstacles. And I think that's what captures the last decade of health literacy in this country, with so much leadership from everyone here and from the IOM. So thank you for being here, and let me start by mentioning my tremendous respect for all of you for being such great pioneers in this progress. I want to congratulate Dr. Victor Zhao, my longtime friend, for being the new IOM president. He's a wonderful choice, a brilliant physician and investigator and leader on many fronts. So I am thankful, Victor, for your presence here today and for making this one of your first appearances in your first 100 days. Dr. Isham has been absolutely tireless, has led this roundtable for many, many years. He tells me this is his last meeting. That can't be true. You're going to be doing this for at least another decade or two, aren't you, Dr. Isham? So thank you so much. Scott Ratson and Ruth Parker have been pioneers in this area. I know they are here, and I want to acknowledge them. I'm speaking today on behalf of my Health and Human Services HHS colleagues, so let me specifically say that Linda Harris, Cindy Brock, and Cynthia Bauer, and many others in our HHS Health Literacy Workgroup taught me and inspired me and are not giving up. They continue to do tremendous work, and I'm going to be referring to some of that progress in my presentation here. The program also lists other wonderful colleagues of mine from previous years, Winston Wong, Steve Teutsch, Dr. Victor Wu, who's a fellow at HHS. And now that I'm back at Harvard, I want to have a special shout out to my colleague Rima Rudd, who's been a wonderful pioneer and also taught me so much about this great field. And if I don't know you yet, please introduce yourself so I can brag about you the next time I speak on this topic. So when I received this invitation, I was delighted because this area of health literacy has been of great relevance to me, both personally and professionally on many levels. First, personally, as an Asian American and as a son of immigrants, I have wrestled with the issues of communication in general and health literacy in particular for a good part of my life. I've wanted to be a physician ever since I was a young age, and from the time I announced that, everybody in my family would refer to me health questions. And then, of course, they would adopt me, especially after I became an MD, to help navigate the healthcare system for family members, particularly older family members like my grandmother's at the time. It was therefore at a very early age that I, on a personal level, encountered all the barriers to good communication, to health literacy in the health system, the cultural and linguistic barriers for my family, a Korean-American family. But over time, I came to realize that my story was just one of millions of stories in this country. And the demographically, we are changing as a nation so dramatically that it's been estimated that by 2043, the United States will be what they call a majority-minority nation, where most of the people in the country will be of racial, ethnic minority backgrounds. I'm from Massachusetts, so I remember when Boston was first declared a majority-minority city around 2000 or 2001. But we have watched very dramatically over time, 7 of the 15 most populous counties in the country being majority-minority counties, and of course, now these projections about the nation becoming majority-minority by 2043. So these are issues that are of relevance to our very diverse country. As Reverend Martin Luther King once said, we may have all come over on different ships, but we're on the same boat now. And I think that applies to this topic. Then health literacy has been of great relevance to me as a practicing physician and clinician who saw patients for over 30 years. Needless to say, when I was in medical school back then, we heard almost nothing about health literacy as a critical topic. And so I, as a young physician, started my career as most providers, assuming that all patients could understand what I was trying to convey as their physician. But I quickly found, as all of you know so well, that there is a major gap between what providers intend to convey and what is understood. And that's what we're talking about today. So the central question is, what does it take for the patient or the client or the consumer to have the capacity to process and understand health information in order to make appropriate health decisions for themselves? That's the heart of the definition of health literacy. And there's so many dimensions to this fascinating concept, whether it's print literacy, writing and reading, oral literacy, listening, speaking, and understanding, numeracy, and numerical understandings, understanding numbers and medication doses, those sorts of issues. As a practicing physician, I had the incredible life experience of caring for many patients with certain types of cancer. So dozens, if not hundreds, perhaps thousands of patients who were referred to me over my career, clinical career, with these forms of cancer. And I was asked to provide a second opinion. Early on as a young physician, when I would walk into the room, I would say, gee, you have this diagnosis, and start in on a little mini lecture about what the cancer was all about, and then stop and ask, do you have any questions? But I quickly came to see that that was the wrong way to approach a doctor-patient encounter, particularly in the opening couple minutes. And over time, it was much more important for me as a clinician to walk into the room, and my first question would be, what is your understanding of what you have, and how do you feel about it? And it was a fascinating way to begin a clinician-patient encounter, because you'd hear a tremendous range of responses. Some patients would say, oh, gee, I've read everything conceivable about this type of cancer. I know I have these three options, and I'm ready to go with option A. And doctor, I hope you're going to support that decision. Then we'd proceed and talk about that. Others would say, gee, I've read everything possible about this. I've gone onto the internet. It scared me. I feel paralyzed. I don't know what to do. Can you please advise me? And so then we would continue the discussion that way. Still, others would say, I'm not a physician. I don't know much about health. You tell me what to do, and I'll follow your directions. So there was a tremendous spectrum, and there are dozens and dozens of stories that I accumulated over the years. But what I came to learn was that you have to start where the patient is. And then you can have a dialogue about where they are and try to together engage in shared decision making to move forward. In hindsight, this was my own way of stumbling upon what you all know as the teach-back method. And I can't tell you how important I think that method is for the future of health literacy, and I know many of you will be commenting on that method as we go forward. But I would say health literacy became most alive for me as a public health topic when I became the Assistant Secretary for Health and Human Services, the ASH, in 2009. It was then I first became aware of the growing body of evidence that limited health literacy leads to a cascade of suboptimal outcomes. It was then that I came to see that we can look at health literacy through many lenses, through specific areas like understanding prescription labels and medication adherence. We'll be talking about that today. Or we could go broader and look at it by disease category, cancer, heart disease, diabetes, HIV, for example. We could go even broader and talk about it by demographic group. I've already talked about the cultural and linguistic barriers that many face in terms of trying to achieve health literacy. We can talk about it by age, how health literacy affects children or seniors, or still broader yet, and this is one of my suggestions for the future, is that much of the conversation we've had on health literacy has been in the clinical realm. That's very important, what happens in a hospital or a doctor's office, perhaps. But can we move this conversation as broadly as possible into the community? Let me give you, and into public health and population health. Let me give you the most current example right now as this nation and the world struggles with Ebola. When you hear the term quarantine through the news, what does that mean to you? And what does that mean to your family or the people around you? Do people understand what that term really means? Does it mean quarantine in a hospital or in a tent on a hospital ground, as happened to the nurse Casey Hickox in New Jersey? Does it mean quarantine in your home? Does it mean you have limited movements, but you can sort of go around as you please and not mingle with large crowds in public? And everyone, when they hear that word, they interpret it differently, and they use that information to protect their own health and the health of their families in different ways. So that's just one example of how, if we expand this conversation into public health and prevention in a time like this, we can bring even more attention to this critically important concept of health literacy. Now, we heard from Dr. Zhao and Dr. Isham about the landmark 2004 report that we are celebrating today, the 10th anniversary. And I'm going to be reviewing what's happened since then with the leadership of so many of you. I would like to propose that we have had at least two major paradigm shifts in health literacy in the last decade, which I am very proud of and you should feel very proud of. The first one is that in the past, health literacy was viewed as a problem for individuals, and that limited health literacy was viewed as a deficit for individual patients and people. Understanding, of course, that individual health literacy is a dynamic concept. But I think we now all understand, as both Dr. Zhao and Dr. Isham have already mentioned, is that this is a systems issue. And if we're going to make progress on health literacy for the next decade and beyond, we have to embrace the concepts of organizational responsibility for health literacy. Instead of just training individuals, providers, for example, we need to get organizational heads involved, talk about the importance of health literate organizations, as IOM and many of you have done, and I think that work has been tremendous. So the big question is, how do we promote systems change for organizations and continue to change the paradigm from talking about individual deficits to responsibilities for organizations? That's number one. The other paradigm shift that has been adopted, which I'm very, very proud of, and I'm jumping in time a little bit, is talking about universal precautions. We used to assume that people, patients, clients would understand unless proven otherwise, but our health discussions in this country have gotten so complex, we should change the paradigm and assume that people are at risk for not understanding unless proven otherwise. And in this time of health reform and marketplaces and insurance reform and the Affordable Care Act. I'll be saying more about this in a couple of minutes. All these health terms are being used. If we just assume everybody understands, or we're just going to compound the health literacy challenges. We have to change and adopt the paradigm of universal precautions, and there are many examples of that I'll get back to in just a second. So those are two major paradigm shifts that I see that have happened in the last decade that we should all be very proud of. And I think a general way to make progress for the future is to engage as many partners as possible in this conversation, traditional and non-traditional, and also weave the health literacy theme into as many other societal cutting-edge themes as possible, because it is such a cross-cutting issue. That way it comes alive and we gain more supporters for this very, very important cause. So for example, today I know we have leaders not only from hospitals and health organizations, but from government, from academia, from foundations, associations, patient and consumer groups. That's tremendous. I know that we need to do more with health plans, with public insurance programs, I'll be saying more about that in a second, with accrediting bodies, that's great. I hope we will continue to reach beyond the health sector, particularly with educational partners. Many of you have shown tremendous leadership there, with pharma and the private sector as well. I know there are efforts to do more in adult education and childcare and areas like that. So this is where the social determinants approach for health literacy is very important, to try to talk about health literacy in all policies. Now, when I became the ASH, the Assistant Secretary for Health in 2009, I was very fortunate to meet my HHS colleagues who had been at this for a long, long time. In fact, they, in 1999, made sure that health literacy was put into the healthy people goals and aspirations for the country. Hopefully all of you know that healthy people is our nation's report card for how we want our country to be healthier for the future. It's a roadmap and compass for our nation. Overseeing healthy people was one of the great joys of my job as Assistant Secretary for Health, and I absolutely loved that whole effort. It's a time-honored effort that involves thousands of community stakeholders and is extended over 4 decades. So my HHS colleagues and others put healthy people goals and objectives first into Healthy People 2010, for the decade leading up to to 2010. And then we have upgraded those goals and objectives for Healthy People 2020, which I unveiled shortly after becoming the ASH. I like to say that we need 2020 vision for healthy people. So if you're not familiar with Healthy People 2020, please go on the healthypeople.gov website. There are many goals and objectives, and there are a number that have to do with health literacy involving measuring how many providers make their instructions to patients easy to understand, asking how many providers use the teach-back method, how many providers are involved in a commitment to shared decision-making with their patients, and we're trying to track those numbers over time. So we're very, very proud of that. I also learned when I started at HHS in 2009 that my colleagues had worked closely with the Department of Education, with many of you as well, so that in 2006, a key national assessment of adult literacy was done, demonstrating some 36% of adults in the U.S. had basic or below basic health literacy needs. So that's a very important outcome that we're still commenting about 8 years later. Cynthia Bauer, Cindy Brock, Linda Harris, and others have also helped the department coordinate research opportunities throughout HHS for health literacy. And then in particular, the Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, ARC, sponsors an annual research conference on health literacy that many of you have attended, and also have put health literacy questions into the CAPS survey, the Consumer Assessment of Healthcare Providers surveys that are publicly available. We're also very proud, by the way, that that's HHS, I'm still an honorary federal employee, I guess. We're very proud that there is a website called healthfinder.gov that is linked to healthcare.gov that builds on health literacy principles to give health information and prevention information to the public. And it's a very busy site, so we're very, very proud of that. Now, the IOM and this roundtable has done a wonderful job at linking this theme with other key cutting-edge societal themes. So in 2009, I was delighted when this workshop summary came out toward health equity and patient-centeredness, integrating health literacy, disparities reduction, and quality improvement. So just in this one title, you've brought health literacy into the worlds of health equity, disparities, quality improvement, patient-centeredness. That's the way to keep this growing and alive. So congratulations for those of you who are part of that. And then you also, of course, have woven this into issues of the Affordable Care Act. And again, a very nice little summary of health literacy implications for healthcare reform that came out of the IOM 2011. I've reviewed these both very carefully, and they're very nice products, again, documenting the progress over the last decade. So congratulations. For the Department of Health and Human Services in 2010, a national strategy for health literacy was released. We're still very proud of that. It's still the only publicly available strategic document on health literacy goals and strategies, and created after tremendous community input. There's some 7 goals articulated there. I'm particularly interested to mention once again goals of building links with childcare, with English language instruction activities, with adult education. That's really reaching out beyond the health sector, a social determinants approach. And I'm very proud that this plan also explicitly addressed culturally and linguistically appropriate services, a theme I've already mentioned now. Our Health and Human Services Office of Minority Health has for the last 13 years put forward what's called CLASS standards, culturally and linguistically appropriate standards. And so again, in the spirit of talking about health equity and disparities reduction, we're all motivated to do this as individuals, but how do we get organizations to do it as a systems approach? These CLASS standards help you get there. And in the summer of 2014, just several months ago, Dr. Nadine Gracia, Myra Alvarez, and I published a little perspective in the New England Journal called Advancing Health with CLASS. I made up the title. So I hope you enjoy reading that, because health literacy is key to that theme. We are very proud that in 2010, Agency for Healthcare Research and Quality, ARC, Cindy Brock and others helped release the Universal Precautions Toolkit, again building on the paradigm change of assuming that people are at risk for not understanding unless proven otherwise. And there are 20 specific steps of this toolkit to try to implement what we call universal precautions, suggestions that are very concrete, such as focusing on teach back, making sure there's a brown bag medication review for your patients so that they really understand what they're taking and how to take it, linking patients to supports in the community and to resources in the community so that they can practice good prevention when they leave the clinical setting and prevent readmissions. And I already mentioned the emphasis and the progress on health literate organizations that have been pioneered by the IOM, so thank you so much for that progress. There is also the Plain Writing Act of 2010 that the president announced, and I remember when that plan was delivered to federal agencies, because it asked all federal agencies to appoint a lead person in each agency to make sure that federal documents were written more understandably. And in fact, in our Department of Health and Human Services, the executive secretary who controlled all the written correspondence was made the head of that effort. And I remember Jen Canistra, the executive secretary at the time, making regular announcements referring to this Plain Writing Act. I know there are reports that are due or perhaps out on the progress of that, so I'm looking forward to hearing what that progress shows. So a lot of these activities I was very proud to see as the ASH, and I wasn't sure if the general public knew much about it. So we were very proud in February 2012 to publish a report in Health Affairs called New Federal Policy Initiatives Can Boost Health Literacy and Help the Nation Move Beyond the Cycle of Costly Crisis Care. And I want to thank my co-authors on this article, Don Berwick, Carolyn Clancy, Cynthia Bauer, Cindy Brock, Linda Harris, and Eileen Zuhausen, for putting that article together and helping us put that forward. But of course, the major transformative moment over the last decade has been the 2010 Affordable Care Act, signed into law by the President on March 23rd. I already mentioned the IOM Roundtable report here on this. And we are at a key time, yet again, with the Affordable Care Act, because just in 9 days, on November 15th, we will have the second round of open enrollment in the marketplace. So we need to ask ourselves, does the public understand what opportunities are available to them to get insurance if they are uninsured? Do people understand basic insurance terms like a deductible and a copay? Do they really understand what that is and how to get on to healthcare.gov and get information and insurance that people need and deserve? I know that after the first round of open enrollment ended, and we were proud to report that over 10 million people received new insurance coverage for the first time, there was a big effort by the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS, to launch what they call a coverage to care campaign that has occurred through the summer, basically doing outreach to people newly insured and saying, congratulations, you now have insurance coverage, but it just, that entails these dimensions, and you should be aware of what new coverage can do to protect your own health. That's what we're all in it for. I was also intrigued that in polls by Kaiser Family Foundation and others, one section of the Affordable Care Act that was wildly popular throughout the country was Section 2715, which calls for standard definitions and uniform explanation of coverage benefits for all plans. So I remember being in some meetings with CMS as my colleagues there were trying to put out some fairly easy to understand pictures and graphs of what the various plans offered in terms of insurance coverage benefits. So I don't know if we have CMS colleagues here, but I am really hoping that can continue to move forward because that will make a great impact on health literacy. Now, one aspect of the Affordable Care Act, which I think is a tremendous opportunity for us, which doesn't receive much attention in the public and the press, is all the Centers for Medicare and Medicaid Services, CMS, efforts to improve quality through new models of care and prevention. We've all heard about Accountable Care Organizations, ACOs. There's a lot of attention to patient-centered medical homes, and the community health centers, for example, have adopted that theme very aggressively. We're very proud of that. There's an initiative called the Community-Based Care Transitions, where we try to link people who are leaving the hospital to providers in the community so people don't fall through the cracks and they don't come back for readmission sooner rather than later. There's emphasis on something called bundled payments. There's a lot of emphasis on people who are dually eligible for Medicare and Medicaid. There's a lot of money spent on that population and money that could be saved while quality could be maintained or improved. And there are innovation challenge grants that come out of CMS that are asking groups to apply, asking teams to come together as partners to put forward new strategies to improve care, improve quality, and lower costs. Health literacy is a huge theme in all those efforts, because as you've already heard from Dr. Zhao and Dr. Isham, when health literacy does not work, extra money is being spent, and we have terribly adverse outcomes and even lives lost. So if we can work on such opportunities, work with groups like CMS, and continue to try to make the business case for health literacy, that's really going to capture the attention of policymakers and budget leaders and others, particularly in cities like DC. So as I end, let me just mention a final effort to talk about ways of promoting systems change for health literacy. We have what we call a cycle of crisis care right now for health, and you all know what it looks like. I mean, imagine this scenario with Mrs. Jones. I mean, when I talk about Mrs. Jones, this will all ring a bell for all of you. She's an older woman without insurance on a fixed income. She has diabetes and heart failure. She comes into the doctor's office, but she's half an hour late for her appointment because the signage was confusing to her. She got lost and didn't know exactly where to go. When she arrives, the receptionist immediately hands her a bunch of forms and asks her to fill them out. She finds them confusing and finds it difficult to understand and complete them as directed. When she finally sees the doctor or provider, he or she is using medical jargon that she really can't understand, but she's too disempowered to ask any questions, so the doctor or provider leaves, and she's not quite sure what she's supposed to do next. She's also handed all these prescriptions that she doesn't really understand, for medications that she doesn't know how to use, and also referrals for lab work and blood work for reasons that she can't quite comprehend. So she's sort of paralyzed that she leaves, and not surprisingly, doesn't get the lab tests, doesn't get some of the prescriptions filled. Shortly after that is admitted to a hospital, is taken care of, discharged, but again, the same process happens when she leaves. And she still has little to no understanding of how she can best take care of herself. We've all been through this as doctors, as patients, as providers, as healthcare CEOs. We've seen this time and again. And we have to move toward a system that's supporting the patient or the client every step of the way. So the last article I mentioned was one that Cindy Brock, Linda Harris, Michael Parchman, and I published in Health Affairs in February of 2013, where we tried to propose what's called a health literate care model. Many of you may have heard about the chronic care model pioneered by first Dr. Ed Wagner, now Dr. Michael Parchman and colleagues, where they talk about how to change systems to help improve patients. They ask us to talk about decision support and clinical information systems and connections community and look at those explicitly and to do assessments of our own organizations. In this article, we talk about how to move organizations more to health literate care organizations. And if we do, then when Mrs. Jones comes back, she comes to the appointment with all her medications in a brown bag because somebody from the office had called ahead and told her that's what she was supposed to do. The receptionist hands her forms that are simple to understand, and somebody's helping her fill them if she has questions. A medical assistant is ready to review her medications with her and make sure that she understands what she's taking and why. When the doctor or provider comes in and talks about the diagnosis and the treatment options, they jointly create a care plan that she can explain in her own words, teach back method. And then when she goes home, she's connected to a diabetes peer support group at the Y that helps her practice prevention the way she can and should. So that's sort of the vision for the future. If we can do that for all patients, all clients, all consumers in healthcare and in public health, and we can build better systems for the next decade and beyond, if we can share best practices at meetings like this, find ways of building better incentives, making the best business case possible with the best data we have, we can certainly make much more progress for health literacy in the future. So thank you so much. As I leave, I do want to think about the hope that you have all generated by being so committed to this area. Again, I'm going to quote Reverend Martin Luther King, who said, "He who has health has hope, and he who has hope has everything." So thank you very, very much.